if we're going to increase food production to feed an ever-burgeoning population, we have to be careful that the food is not contaminated. The public must have confidence in where their food came from and that there's nothing in that food that could cause problems. How do we ensure that? Well, joining me now is the head of food science and technology for the Bühler Group, Béatrice Conde. Welcome, Béatrice. How much confidence do you think the public have in what they eat?
I think in general, people consume, eat, they go out, they go to restaurants. And I would say in general, they feel quite confident. But there is a but to it. When they give food to their children, they might be thinking twice, you know, is this really safe? They read in the press, they see on social media. You see more and more issues, scandals, and that is eroding the trust of consumers.
So this is what we call food fraud, is that correct?
That is food safety issues. Food fraud is when you have, for instance, adulteration. So that is the intentional, for instance, addition of something to food.
Saying something's steak from cows, but it's actually horse meat or something like that. That would be food fraud.
That would be food fraud if the origin is faked. There is unfortunately a lot of food fraud around organic, for instance. It's sold as organic, but has not been grown as organic. Or that you add something so that it appears of a higher quality. In spices, it can be a dye. And in milk powder, as it occurred in China, it was a component which is not food grade, it's chemical, so that it appeared with a higher protein content, although it was obviously not, and this was poisonous for children. So this is the issue of food fraud, and it's a continuum between food safety and food fraud.
Mm.
We are today talking more about food fraud because we have a very globalized and very fragmented supply chain. And it has become easy for some criminals to adulterate our food. And we have today more sophisticated methods to find out. And that's why we hear more also about food fraud.
But there is a danger, is there not, that because we are trying to create more food, grow more crops, create more products, because we're talking about by 2050 the population being 9.8 billion, mm-hmm. that somewhere along the line in that race for more food, standards drop?
I don't think that we have that risk, because at the end we have consumers who are always better educated, they are empowered, and also companies are not necessarily interested in dropping the standards. So I think the holy grail is achieving this safe food, but also doing it in a very efficient way. So it starts really at the field. The whole post-harvest, for instance, management of grains becomes more and more important. At the end, grain handlers and millers become the gatekeepers of food safety. So in fact, that's a new role that they have acquired over the last 10 years. So it goes through the whole value chain. And if you do it properly, you can also become more efficient. You can reduce waste. And that is one of the biggest opportunities that we have also when we combine food safety with efficiency in the value chain.
So a company like Bühler, what do you contribute that helps the end user, the consumer, know that that transparency is there, that they can see the food chain, that they know and have reassurance that everything is safe?
I think there the digital revolution is really contributing to increase the transparency across the value chain. A consumer can engage today differently. By getting this information, it can be a QR code or other type of information to find out what is in there, where is this coming from, where has this been grown. But then also for the different players in the value chain, this information is very valuable to create trust. So I would say it's trust for all the stakeholders in the value chain, and obviously the strong pull coming from the consumer side.
And your job title brings in the words science and technology. Very important?
Very important. Because we have this digital revolution. You have many tools. You have sensors, you have cloud, you have data analytics. You have blockchain, so you can have this information put into the cloud, which is immutable, so that it cannot be changed, so that the consumer or those who are processing this material can access this information, or at least information which is necessary for these different players. But, and there now I lost what I wanted to say.
Don't worry about it. Well, let me ask you another question. I'm just wondering whether there is a bit of a fight in terms of what you're trying to do. A fight in that, on one hand, people like you are being told you must give us more food because the population is rising. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, we're telling you, but we want you to cut your waste. We want you to cut the amount of water you use. We want you to cut the amount of energy you use. How do you reconcile both of those?
Both will be important. Obviously, we need to produce more food. And it is not only about more food, we need to cut the waste, because the waste is potentially also food. And cutting waste can be, for instance, having less out of spec product, which is produced and never reaches the market. Or when we look at the beginning of the value chain, we have a lot of grains or crops which are contaminated by a fungus that produces a toxin, the so-called mycotoxin. These cannot be cooked away or inactivated. So you need to remove these contaminated grains from the value chain. So ideally, you just remove the contaminated grains and can use the rest, rather than destroying a whole lot. So there are different ways how science and technology help us to prevent issues, or if issues are there, that we can take them under control, or that we do the right processing so that we reduce the risk. And at the end, it's about finding this precision processing, not an over-processing. I think that is the challenge. One example would be nuts. You know, nuts have been roasted forever for the color, for the taste, for the texture. Today, when you roast nuts, you also have to take care of the inactivation of potentially harmful bacteria. And there is where we can help from Bühler's side. We can monitor the roasting process with temperature sensors and other sensors that control, for instance, the mass flow. We know very well at which conditions bacteria die. But based on these records that we have on the process monitoring, we can do basically an inline calculation of how many bacteria are dying at that moment in the roaster. So it's a very elegant way of getting insights into processes and increasing the confidence of the processors that the risks have been indeed reduced to the level they need. And that also builds trust at the end with the consumers.
Sure. I see why technology is so important. Final question then. You and your colleagues and your peers within this industry, how confident are you that we will be able to feed a population that's going to grow to 9.8 billion people?
I'm optimistic, but the challenges are huge. So we need to react now. We need to have the solutions on the market by 2025, solutions that make a big difference, because we then still have some years to create impact. Within 10 years, we need to fix our agro-food system to provide sufficient food and not at the expenses of the health of our planet.
Wow, what a challenge. Good luck with it.
Thank you.
You very much indeed, Beatrice Conde. Thank you.